Dr. Cuddy, go right ahead.
And on 9/11, I remember watching it as it was unfolding. And the first figure they gave, ultimately, is about 3,000 killed. But the first figure they gave, it looks like about 5,500 people have been killed. Of course, that's because up on the upper floors, while the word was going out, stay at your desk, stay at your desk, one security person went around with a bullhorn saying, leave your desk, get out of the building, because he knew, had the good sense, and he lost his life, actually saving all those other couple of thousand people to get out of there. And then in Afghanistan, we went into Afghanistan and then did a real quick turn to the west and into Iraq, of course, right? I mean, if you're going after Al-Qaeda in eastern Afghanistan and Waziristan, of course you want to begin a major operation in Iraq, right? I mean, that's the logical thing to do. Not really.
You know what we really wanted to do, number one, was to secure the drug fields there in Afghanistan. Yep. The Taliban wanted to burn down the drug fields, and American troops were there guarding the drug fields so we could have the world drug trade, because that's how the CIA gets a lot of their money. And then, of course, they wanted to get into Iraq, because that's where a lot of the oil was, and certainly we've ensured a ready supply of oil from Iraq, because, of course, we had to go to Iraq because of the weapons of mass destruction. And the president guaranteed that those weapons were there, and he was lying, and Colin Powell lied, and Dick Cheney lied. And where is the call for, Sidney, a retribution for lying to the American people and taking us into another unnecessary war? And there is none. Go right ahead.
Yeah, same thing in Vietnam. And if you want to go back, that same general area in China with the British and the Boxer Rebellion and the Opium Wars and so on. Yeah, they make a lot of money off of drugs and the heroin from the poppy fields and opium and so forth. So, yeah, that's where they get their black ops money, the off-budget items and, you know, Iran-Contra and the whole bit. So, what we had to do was get over to Iraq really quickly, and there's no need to revisit all that. But in terms of Bergdahl, you have to at least ask yourself. Now, I'm not saying this is what happened, but you have to at least ask yourself if this wasn't some sort of planned thing. Because
Hold that thought, Dennis. We'll be right back here in a moment. Well, this is Dr. Stan, as we talked about the background of the Afghan war. It was phony. We got into the war because, of course, the attack by the terrorists on the World Trade Center, only it wasn't a terrorist attack. It was a controlled demolition. All you need to do is watch Building 7 come down. Go up and watch Building 7 come down. See how the center of the roof caves in first. That's what you do, so the walls fall in. Then you take out the base of the building, and they killed 3,000 people because they wanted to go to war in Afghanistan. And then, of course, we got into the war in Iraq. But now, of course, Dennis is talking about Bergdahl. What's the significance of this so-called young man who supposedly defected to the Taliban and now he's been released? What are your interpretation of what's going on? And is there more to this than we're being told?
It may be. I don't want anybody to say, well, Cuddy says this is what's really going on, because I'm just saying these are the types of things that you want to ask questions about. Like, if this is simply a guy who's gone over there and loves the Taliban, and he did do strange things. I mean, he would go leave his post without his weapons and so on, and there was a fellow a cleric down near some swampy area, and he would go down there and say, hey, which way is the Taliban? And the cleric said, well, they're over that way, but you better not go there. Well, yeah, I want to go see them and meet them. Some children said the same thing. They said, don't go there. The Taliban's there. And he says, yeah, I want to go see the Taliban. If it's simply something like that, then you have to ask yourself, why did he wander off base in California? I mean, this is not the first time he just sort of wandered off somewhere. So what is this wandering thing? Was he sort of getting sheep-dipped, as they call it, sort of setting the stage for something else? Was he bugged? A lot of times when soldiers, if the military plans for them to do certain dangerous things, deliberately dangerous things, or things that don't seem quite right, what they have is they have them chipped. You know, is this a way of, if he's chipped and they take him captive, that they can follow where they are, not just he is, but where those Taliban people are? Is that one of the things? And another thing is they were exchanged. He was exchanged for five leading members of the Taliban. These are members back around the 2001 area. They were captured really early, the military commanders and all the intelligence guys. So these are really the worst of the worst. Another question I have, I don't know this is true, but I would just be curious to find out if any of those five guys had at Gitmo been anesthetized for anything. You know, a tooth has to be removed. Okay, come, we're going to go to the dentist and hear sniff this, and after the dental operations, oh, you're okay. Go back. I mean, whenever anybody like that goes under anesthetic, you don't really know if they also secretly have been chipped. So, I mean, I'm not saying they were. I'm just saying it would be interesting to know if any of those five guys had an operation performed while they were at Gitmo. And so, I'm not saying this is what happened, but I'm really suspicious of certain things that are certain operations that our military does, which seem to be sort of stupid, but you don't know if they're really setting these guys up. Now these five guys go back over there, right? And they become very active, and they get to meet, you know, with various people who would be like Mullah Omar and all these guys. And if we've chipped them, now we know where the other guys are. And so, I'm just a little suspicious of this whole thing. It's just a little strange here. So, anyway, another part of what's strange about that whole thing is, if you look at the helicopter that went in to pick up Bergdahl, you have to figure these people who go into that helicopter are either the biggest idiots in the world or something is fishy about it. Because the helicopter, it goes in to pick him up. Now, if I'm a person with any intelligence at all, you know, sort of like the guy who's going to meet somebody under the bridge at midnight, meet me under the bridge at midnight with your secret information. And you say, well, no, I don't think I'll meet you under the bridge at midnight. Let's go meet in the grocery store with 1,000 people all around us. So the last thing you want to do, if you're going to go into the midst of the Taliban and pick somebody up, is you don't want to go into, like, this ravine area, this area which is surrounded by higher ground, because that sort of looks real fishy. It looks like a setup, like, as in, here comes the helicopter, and all of a sudden, boom, 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 and you're wiped out, right? And, you know, so they landed in the bad place in the first place. And then secondly, they get out of the helicopter, they go get Bergdahl, and they come back to the helicopter, and then when they're back at the helicopter, they're frisking him, all right? They frisk him at the helicopter. Now, do you really want to do that? I mean, don't you, when you leave the helicopter and go to where Bergdahl is, don't you want to frisk him there just in case he's wired or something? You don't bring him back to the helicopter and frisk him there, because if he is wired for an explosive, then you're going to blow up the helicopter. So not only is he going to be blown up, but you haven't got any way out of there. You're stuck. You know, the helicopter's blown up. You're blown up. Everybody's blown up. So what's with the frisking only after they've reached the helicopter? So we got to either have some idiots or something else is going on here. All right, the next thing is if things are transpiring logically, and my suspicious nature shouldn't be so suspicious, then what you have in real life, as it were, is five of the key Taliban guys going back there. Now, Obama said the other day, well, you know, we have this deal with the country over there. That they will be, you know, not just allowed to do whatever they want to do. And so the people in Qatar, Q-A-T-A-R, sometimes they say Qatar and all that, but they say, no, they're not prisoners. You know, their wives and family coming over and visiting, they're living it up. They're living it up. Well, now the pressure, even if those guys didn't want to rejoin the fight, the pressure is going to be tremendous by the Taliban, the other existing Taliban members, for them. They'll say, hey, we want you guys back here. You're heroes. You're the symbol. You know, you're our fearless leaders. And secondly, if you're one of these five guys at Gitmo, And if you've been mistreated at all in any way, I mean, who thinks Gitmo is pleasant? It may be not terrible. They may not be getting whipped every day of their life, but it's not a happy place for them. Then these guys who are jihadists to begin with are really going to want revenge, right? So as soon as they can, as soon as they possibly can, because they really hate us even more now, and because their friends, their allies, the Taliban, who is already over there, will be pressuring them, hey, come on back, you're our leaders, you know, you need to. What's the matter? You guys a bunch of wimps? They taking the fight out of you? He goes, no, they haven't taken the fight out of you. I hate those Americans. See, so these guys are going to go back into battle, right? And now what's the new message? The new message is, guess what? We can kidnap Americans. And not just American soldiers, but we can kidnap any Americans and look at what we can get for it. So I can see them already planning. All right, let's see now. There's an oil executive coming tomorrow to Kabul, and he's going to be guarded by, you know, seven security guys from Blackwater or wherever. But the Taliban, they're looking at this. They're, okay, seven security guys, we can blow them out of the we'll get rid of them. And now they might have a big oil executive. Now, if you got an average sort of civil servant, the government will say, yeah, we're working. Yeah, whatever, we're working. But if you have a top oil executive, then that oil company is going to put a lot of pressure on the government and say, we want our oil executive back. And so here we go. And this time they're going to want 20 guys from Gitmo. We'll give you the oil executive from the XYZ oil company, but you, this time, you got to give us 20 nasty fighters that you got at Gitmo. So that the message has gone out, it's time to kidnap Americans, wherever you are. Nigeria, you know, it doesn't matter. If there's any Americans walking around Nigeria, Boko Haram say, hey, let's grab them. But never mind these 200 Nigerian girls. We can get an American oil executive in Nigeria, and look at what the Taliban was able to do. We ought to be able to get, you know, a few missiles, whatever they say. Give us 20 missiles, and we'll give you your oil executive back. So now the message, the precedent has been set to go grab an American. You know, grab an American day. It'll be, and they'll have posters. You know, you too can grab an American in Germany or wherever. All right, so you know, that's the precedent that's been set as well. Now, there's a couple of other items in the news. One of them you may have seen recently, these two girls who stabbed, I think it was like 19 times, their friend, about the same age, around 12 years of age, because they were mimicking this long-armed, you know, the fictional character in the woods and so forth and so on. And when I looked at the two girls, they actually looked like refugees from a Harry Potter movie, right? And that shows you the tremendous influence that the media or movies or music have on youngsters at about that age. Because if you go and talk to the people in Wiccan, which is the witch's religion, they will tell you that a lot of their 25, 30-year-old Wiccan members started years ago, 20 years ago, as little Harry Potter devotees, right? So this is where they get their recruitment from. Remember I told you some months ago about the rock group Judas Priest, where they're just do it, the two boys who committed suicide because there was a subliminal message in this just do it thing, and one of the boys who just before he died, he fatally wounded himself, but just before he died, he said it was like the music had possessed us, right? So you're getting these messages that are very, very persuasive. Last night, I was flipping around the TV, and I came upon this sitcom, and, you know, the music is playing, and everybody's, you know, chuckle, and so on. Well, the message was in this one girl has just gotten engaged to this fellow in the sitcom. It's very popular about, you know, 15 years ago, and now it's replaying. But remember, it began about 15 years ago on regular network television. And about 15 years ago, the girl was looking and says, oh, gee, Tom, or whatever his name is, don't you have some negative feelings about our marriage? And he said, well, what do you mean? He says, oh, you know, now when we're married, we won't have the excitement of having sex with lots of different guys, she was saying, for herself. She said, you know, a new sexual experience, the rush and all that, and the audience went, ha, 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 like that, right? But that sends a message, right? It sends a message to all these little 12-year-olds, whether they're looking at Harry Potter, whether they're looking at this long-armed creature that's grabbing kitties in the, into the woods and so forth, doing some occultic rituals, or whether it's these young adults on these sitcoms were very much admired. They're on all the magazines, you know, People, and all that stuff. So what do you think the 12-year-old child's going to do when it looks at this girl? The 12-year-old's looking at this girl 15 years ago. Oh, you know, don't you regret not being able to have sex with all these guys and the rush and the wonderful new experience? Gee, Tom, don't you really regret that? I mean, what kind of message is